Welcome, friends. We're so glad you could join us today for another study of God's Word. We're in the book of Philippians, chapter 4. So if you have your Bibles, I'd encourage you to turn to that great book, and we'll jump into that right after our prayer. Thanks again for joining us today. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for your love and your mercy. Thank you for loving us and giving us your revelation. Especially thank you for the great book of Philippians at this time that builds our faith, that gives us a sense of joy, that we can rely on you in all things. Help us to glean much from the text today in our study. Please bless each hearer, Father. Help us to truly, rightly divide your word today. Thank you again for all things. In Jesus' name, amen. Philippians chapter 4 is such a great chapter. Here Paul is going to introduce the secure mind. Remember, we talked about chapter 1 being the single mind, chapter 2 being the submissive mind, chapter 3 being the spiritual mind, and here Paul is going to introduce the secure mind. You know, the mind is such a powerful tool. It can be used for such great things, but it also can be used for terrible things as well. And what we focus upon and what we really meditate upon determines our actions. It's so true. What we think about is so important. And it's sad to me, but many today are walking around with insecure minds and unstable thoughts. Well, let me tell you, if anybody ever had an excuse for having some unstable thoughts, it surely would have been the Apostle Paul, especially as he wrote the letter to the Philippians. Think about some of the things that were going on in Paul's life at this point. Number one, Paul was struggling with the carnality of the church in many places. Even here in Philippi, he was struggling with the fact that some weren't getting along. Philippians chapter 4, verses 2 and 3, and we'll look at that in just a few minutes. Added to that burden and care for the churches was the possibility, the very real possibility, of Paul's own death. He didn't know that he was going to get out of this imprisonment. Now, looking back, we know that he did get out of this imprisonment, but it was only a couple of years later that he was arrested again and he didn't get out of that second imprisonment. And we know that he did die for the cause of Christ. That had to be weighing heavy upon Paul's mind. And so Paul had these burdens. He had these cares of which he was really struggling and really thinking about. But it was amazing to me. It is amazing to me. Paul did not allow those struggles to take away his joy, to take away his purpose, to take away what his real focus was in the Christian walk. And so in this chapter, he introduces the secure mind. And how can you and I have the type of mind we need to have in a world that literally often falls apart? Our circumstances bring us great difficulty. Our situation, sometimes people in our lives bring us great difficulty. How can we have the secure mind? Well, Paul is going to bring our mind to three major thoughts in this great chapter. He begins verses 1 through 9 with God's peace. Let's look at chapter 4, Philippians, verses 1 through 9. Read them with me, then we'll break them down together. God's peace. Therefore, my brethren, dearly beloved and longed for, my joy and crown, so stand ye fast in the Lord, my dearly beloved. I beseech Euodias and beseech Syntyche that they be of the same mind in the Lord. And I entreat thee also, true yoke fellow, help those women which labored with me in the gospel, with Clement also, and with other my fellow laborers whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. Let your moderation be known unto all men, the Lord is at hand. Be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. Those things which ye have both learned and received and heard and seen in me, do, and the God of peace shall be with you. Now, I want you to notice, Paul is going to bring our mind's eye to securing our mind, to bringing our thoughts into the captivity of Jesus Christ. He does so in these first nine verses by looking majorly at God's peace. peace. I want you to notice how he does that. First of all, he does so with a commendation. Verse 1, he starts out this chapter with a commendation. Look at the commendation. Therefore, he's tying up the letter. He's bringing all that he's had to say at this point up into a bow. Therefore, my brethren, dearly beloved and longed for, my joy and crown, so stand fast in the Lord, my dearly beloved. Notice the commendation. If we want to enjoy a secure mind, if we want to notice that God's peace, if we want to have that peace in our lives, it begins with having a secure mind. And that secure mind begins with standing fast in the Lord. Notice Paul didn't say, hey, if your circumstances are bad, go ahead and falter. Go ahead and leave the Lord. Blame him for everything that negative happens in your life. It's not what he said. He said, therefore, my beloved brethren, you people that are my joy and crown, he said, stand fast, be solid, be secure. It reminds me how he concluded chapter 15 of the book of 1 Corinthians. My beloved brethren, be steadfast, always abounding in the work of the Lord, so much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. That's what he's saying here. Stand fast. That's Paul's commendation for the secure mind. But in that, Paul also, secondly, brings forth a confrontation. And here's something that is very important for us to understand. If we are going to have the peace of God, there are times we have to confront things that are not right in our lives and sometimes in our congregations. Notice verses 2 and 3, Paul brings a confrontation. I beseech Euodias and beseech Syntyche that they be of the same mind in the Lord. And I entreat thee also, true yoke fellow, help those women which labored with me in the gospel, with Clement also, and with other my fellow laborers whose names are written in the book of life. I want you to notice how he confronts this situation. Now, we don't have all the details, but we do have enough details to notice there was two women in the church at Philippi who were not getting along. They apparently were causing some problems. There was a division in this church, and it bothered Paul, but Paul didn't just sort of ignore it. Paul didn't just let it go. Paul confronted the situation. Now, this is a good note for leaders to take. Sometimes situations need confronted in the church. When there's division in a congregation, it needs confronted. I've seen people just sort of turn a blind eye to division and confrontation. They won't confront a sin. They won't confront a situation. But I want you to notice how Paul confronted it. Notice, number one, he confronted it personally. He said, I beseech Euodias and Syntyche. He did it personally. Paul wasn't afraid to go and talk to these ladies by name. Now, he wasn't in person at this point. He was writing this letter that was probably going to be sent with Epaphroditus. But Paul was making sure that he mentioned these two ladies by name. You are at odds in the church. He said, I'm talking about you two. He didn't sort of just give a generalization. He talked specifically and personally. But secondly, I want you to notice how he confronted the situation, not only personally, but he did it kindly. Paul said, I beseech you, I beseech Euodias, I beseech Syntyche. He did it kindly. Paul wasn't about being a mean-spirited person. He did so kindly. Beseech carries with it the idea of begging or pleading with them. He said, I'm pleading with you two sisters. Please don't do this. Don't be divisive. Don't be separated. Don't cause grief in this congregation. The Lord's church is too beautiful for you two women to cause an uproar here in Philippi. He did so kindly. Thirdly, I want you to notice how he confronted them, not only personally, not only kindly, but he also did so very directly. What was their problem? Well, they weren't thinking the right way. So he said, I beseech Syntyche and Euodias that they be of the same mind in the Lord. Paul said directly, you people aren't getting along. You aren't of the same mind. You're thinking about the wrong thing. And he said, I am encouraging you to be of the same mind. He did so very directly. He dealt with the problem. Paul confronted them personally. He confronted them kindly. He confronted them directly. And then fourthly, he went there and he confronted them competently. Notice, he said in verse 3, I entreat thee also, true yoke fellow, help those women which labor with me in the gospel. So he's addressing the leadership, those who've worked with Paul before. Yoke fellow, the idea of somebody joined together as a team of oxen would be. Paul uses that analogy. My yoke fellow, my fellow laborers, my brethren in the Lord. He said, I'm telling you, you guys encourage this situation. Help this situation. He did so very competently. Help those women. There was a problem in the church. Listen, dear friends, when there's a problem in the church, any congregation, we can't just gloss over that problem. Let me tell you what problems will do in a church. Problems will fester. They will become worse every single time. Letting a situation go does not help that situation. Now, there is a right way to handle it. Sometimes it requires patience. Sometimes it requires stepping back and really letting the thing play out a little bit so we could see exactly what the problem is. But we cannot let it go. We can't gloss over it. We can't overlook it. We must deal with the problem. Paul confronts the situation. You want to have the peace of God in the church of our Lord? Sometimes you have to confront things. How do you confront them? Confront them personally. Confront them kindly. Confront them very directly. And confront them competently. You get the right leadership. You get the right people to handle the situation. You don't ask a babe in Christ, somebody who's not been a Christian very long, to help with a situation. You get people who are competent to help with that particular situation. Paul begins in verse 1 with a commendation. He moves in verses 2 and 3 to a confrontation. And then verses 4 through 5, he talks about the evaluation. Look at verses 4 and 5. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. Let your moderation be known unto all men. The Lord is at hand. It's interesting to me because Paul delves into this problem that was at Philippi. Now, he doesn't spend a great deal amount of time on it. He just tells them, here's what you need to do. And then in verses 4 and 5, he brings forth this evaluation. In other words, everyone there, you need to evaluate yourself. What's the evaluation all about? Two different parts. Number one, their attitude. Look at verse 4. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say, rejoice. That leads me to believe, and I believe very logically, that that problem in the church at Philippi had taken some of the joy away from those Christians. They had been sort of zapped of their joy, if you will. Paul brings it back. He said, rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. Don't let this get you down. He said, you get your spirits back up. You check your attitude. And then secondly, he said, you check your appearance. Verse 5. Let your moderation, the old King James says. Some newer translations use the word gentleness. I love that. Let your gentleness be known unto all men. The Lord is at hand. I don't know if you've ever experienced this or not. I've been able to witness this. I've been able to experience this. Sometimes problems in a church will cause people in that church to become very calloused and harsh and negative. And it's interesting, you can usually see it on their face and hear it in their expressions. You know, brethren and friends, the church of our Lord is too precious for us to become negative, for us to become condescending, for us to become very pessimistic. That's not what the church is about. If there's a problem in the church, we need to confront that problem. We need to deal with that problem. But let us always remember that where there are people, there will be problems. Let's handle that problem right, and then let's get back to check our own attitude. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. And then our appearance, are we being gentle? Are we the kind of people that we need to be, or are we brass? Are we just kind of very rough and hard-hearted people? That's not what Christianity is about. Christianity is about kindness and joy and peace and love. And so if there is a congregational problem, you fix the congregational problem, and then you move on. You keep rejoicing in the Lord. I want you to think about, not only does Paul give the commendation in verse 1, the confrontation, verses 2 and 3, the evaluation in verses 4 and 5, but then he moves to a determination. Here's what you people at Philippi need to do, and really, here's a recipe for Christianity. If you wanted to sum it up, it lies in verses 6 through 9. It lies in three areas. Three areas, Paul says, be determined to do this. Now, I want you to put it in its context. The church at Philippi had experienced a problem. There was some things going on there that shouldn't have been going on, and Paul was encouraging them. He was trying to build them back up. That's one great thing that evangelists do. That's one great thing that preachers do. Now, there are times that, you know, we need to preach, and some of those sermons are hard. But let me tell you, ultimately, the Word of God is encouraging. It builds us. Even when there's a problem, we deal with the problem scripturally, but then we move on. We move past that problem. I've known preachers in the past that have sort of got on hobby horses, and they'll ride that hobby horse. It's not really our job as evangelists, as preachers, to ride hobby horses. Our job is to encourage people with the Word of God, and it is encouraging. There are times we need to confront situations. There are times we need to preach on hard subjects. But boy, I tell you what, we need to make sure that we're preaching the whole counsel of God. And let me tell you, the whole counsel of God is very, very uplifting. It is very encouraging. Now notice, Paul says, make this your determination. Three things. Number one, right praying. Look at verses 6 and 7. Be careful, or as some translations read, be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God, and the peace of God which passeth all understanding shall guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus our Lord. Now I want you to notice how Paul breaks this right praying down into three different areas. Number one, he says, pray. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer. What is this prayer that he's talking about? Well, prayer here involves adoration. Adoration. So notice, when worry or a situation arises, here it was anxiety, probably and most likely linked to everyday struggles, also linked to some congregational problems. When worry strikes, the first thing we should do is get alone with the Lord. And the word prayer here is unique because it literally carries with it the idea of adoration or worship. And so it is the case that the first thing we ought to do when confronted with a situation is be on our knees praising and adoring God. You know, I find this out personally. You can try it and see if it doesn't work for you. When my problems seem gigantic and my situations around me seem enormous, when I get on my knees and I pray to God and I praise Him and I worship Him, I leave that time of worship realizing my problems aren't quite as big as I initially thought. There is something that really happens. It changes us when we pray and we worship God, when we extol and adore God. Worship is for God, but dear friends, worship is for us. He said, be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer. Secondly, he uses a word after prayer and supplication. Supplication is a word that literally means an earnest sharing of our needs and problems. And so it is the case that when worry strikes, when anxiety comes about, what do? We drop to our knees and we pray, we extol, and we worship God. The second thing, a part of that prayer, a part of that sequence, is supplication. We are pleading with God to help our situation. You know, there's strength and there's power in prayer. I'll tell you, dear friends, we as Christians often do not tap into that resource. Prayer is not a go-to when we have problems. Don't misunderstand prayer. Prayer is a daily communication with our Father. And I'll tell you, daily communication with our Father will help us in the time of problems. But notice, we don't pray just when we have problems. We are constantly communicating with our Father. Prayer is a part of our daily life as God's children. Hebrews 5 and verse 7, Jesus was in supplication, Hebrews 5 and verse 7 tells us, when he was in the Garden of Gethsemane. When he was pouring out his heart to God, he was being in supplication. He was pleading with God to help his spiritual requests. Now, here's something I want us to notice about supplication. It's not so much about physical energy. Supplication is about spiritual intensity. Do you remember whenever Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane, his sweat became like great drops of blood? What was that? That was spiritual intensity. Jesus was so focused on pleading with his Father, on talking to his Father, that his sweat became like great drops of blood. Dear friends, there's something to be said when there's a problem, when anxiety strikes. If we'll just simply use the tools God gave us, drop to our knees in prayer, drop to our knees in supplication, but don't forget the third one. Paul doesn't stop there. He said, be careful for nothing but in everything by prayer and supplication. But how do we do that? Wait a second, Paul, I'm all stressed out here. Are you kidding me? The third one is with thanksgiving. What father does not relish his children saying thank you? Our Heavenly Father relishes, loves, longs to hear our thanksgiving. Dear friends, prayer is not a vending machine where we put in our coins and we hit our request and God drops it from the sky. That's not what prayer is. Prayer is a lifeline. Prayer is our lifeline of communication to our Father. I don't know about you, but I love it when my children, even if they need something, while they're asking me for something, they are thankful for what they have. That means a great deal to me as a father. I can only imagine what that must mean to my Heavenly Father. When I do need something, I need to go and ask God. For sure, He tells us to request things. But in the same light, may we never request something without giving our thanksgiving for what He's already done and what He already does. I'm reminded of Luke chapter 17, 11 through 19. You remember the story of those 10 lepers? Jesus healed them and they all went away, but one returned, just one returned to say thank you. Why do you suppose that narrative is in the Bible? Oh, it's a true narrative, but why did the Holy Spirit put it in there for us? I believe there's a valuable lesson, and it really deals with thanksgiving. Do we care enough to stop and say thank you to God? Listen, there are things we need. I know there are things you need today. There are things I need today. But let me tell you, if I look at the list that God has already given me, I'm going to be on my knees with thanksgiving. Right praying involves prayer, which in extolling, adoring, and worshiping God. Supplication, pleading with God for my needs. With thanksgiving, appreciating what God has already done. Paul said, this determination every day must be found in number one, right praying. Number two, right thinking. Verse 8. Oh, we cannot emphasize this enough. Look at verse 8. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true. I want you to notice each one of these. This is amazing to me. As I studied this, I had to really think about this. And I'll tell you, sometimes I fall right into this category, the opposite of what I should fall into. I think wrongly. Do you ever have that problem? Paul said, listen, if you want to be anxious free, if you want to be stress free, you learn to pray right, you learn to think right. Look at verse 8. Finally, my brethren, whatsoever things are true. It's interesting. Studies have shown that only 8% of what we worry about ever come true. Only 8%! The other 92% are things that are, listen, imaginary, things that never come true, or things over which we have no control. Did you notice that? What was Paul's very first formula in right thinking? He said, hold on a second. Before you let your mind run wild, think about it. Is it really true? Is it true? You know, that condemned me. There are times I think about things that I have no control over. I worry about them. I'm stressed about them, and I have no control over them at all. Paul said, make sure you think, but before you start thinking about things, let your mind go off. You make sure your thinking is right. Is it true? Then secondly, he says, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest. Some translations use the word honorable here. Listen to what the word literally means. It means lofty things that lift the mind in a positive moral direction. Did you notice that? Paul said, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest or honorable. Just ask yourself this. Thus far today, what have your thoughts been focused on? I mean, what have you really has occupied the amount of your mind? What are you thinking about right now? Is it honorable? Is it morally uplifting? Is it positive? I'll tell you what, this condemns a lot of us. We have a tendency to dwell on negative things. It is no wonder. It is no wonder to me, dear friends, that there's so much sadness and depression and anxiety and hatred in our world today. We don't think on the right things. They're not honorable things that we're focused on. Paul said, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest or honorable, whatsoever things are just. This word literally means something that is worthy of respect. Listen carefully. Some things in life, some thoughts in life are not respect worthy, and they should not consume my thoughts. Can I say this in love? there are some people that should not consume my thoughts. Now, I'm not saying those people are not respect worthy. We need to respect to the best of our ability everyone. So I'm not giving us a license to disrespect people. But what I am saying is this. Paul said, whatsoever things are just, there are some folks that just are not just people. They're not worthy of dignity and respect because of the way they conduct themselves. If I focus on those type of people, I'm going to be brought down to their level. Listen, dear friends, my mind is powerful and so is yours. We need to think on things that are just. Notice fourthly, what sort of things are true, what sort of things are honorable, what sort of things are just, whatsoever things are pure. This literally means morally undefiled. It's the same word from which we get our word holy or sacred or sanctified. Notice what Paul's saying here. He's saying if you're going to let your mind run wild on things that are true. Is it really true? Is it really honorable? Is it morally uplifting? Is it positive? Let your mind focus on things that are just, worthy of respect. Let your mind focus on things that are morally undefiled, that are holy, that are sanctified, that are set apart. Number five, he said, let your mind focus on things that are lovely. This word means something that evokes a response of love. I don't want to think about things that evoke a response of hate. I want to think about things that are lovely, things that really bring a response out of me that are lovely. I don't want those hatred and that negative thought to consume me to where what will happen? Hate and negative thoughts will come out of me. I want things that are lovely, and so I must guard my mind. Number next, Paul said, think on things that are of whatsoever things are of good report. Literally a well report. Well. Now, I want you to think about this. He's not talking about filth here. He's not talking about gossip. He's not talking about negative things, but that which is positive and spiritually appealing. I want to make a plea to my brethren here. I want you to really think about this, something that is of good report. Sometimes among people, and I suppose brethren are just people, so sometimes we have this problem. Sometimes we get on our phones and we pick up our telephones and our cell phones and our Facebook accounts and our Instagrams, and we tweet and we post and we call and we propagate things that are not of good report. I want to encourage you, if you're a child of God, to stop that immediately. Why, we don't really look at gossip as something that important anymore, do we? In fact, sometimes people almost think that if it's true, it's okay to say. Doesn't mean it's okay to say. Is it of good report? Is it something that's going to build somebody else up? There are lots of negatives. I could pick up my phone today and I could call somebody and I could talk about all the negatives that I experience. But I'll tell you, there are a lot of positives. Is it of good report? Brethren, make this part of your life. If somebody tweets you, if somebody posts something on Facebook, if they call you and it's not of good report, learn to shut that off immediately. If it's a telephone conversation, here's what I would encourage you to say. I'm sorry, but I'm training my mind to think on good things, and that is not something that is good. Now, oftentimes people will just say, well, I'm just venting. Let me tell you, a lot of venting is nothing but garbage. It's just spewing out things that should not be spewed out. I'm not against venting. There's a place for it, but it's not throughout our congregations. We don't need to be venting to everyone in our congregations. That is spewing out filth. It's not something of good report. Check your Facebook posts. Who are you following on Facebook? Are they of good report or are they negative? Listen, I'm not on Facebook, but I understand this to be true. You can unfollow people. Dear friends, there are some people that need to be unfollowed on your Facebook. Go ahead and have the courage to do that. Go ahead and have the courage to unfollow people. Go ahead and have the courage to block people. If they are not telling you things and talking to you and building you up things of good report, sometimes you have to cut those relationships off. Now, I know that's harsh, and that sounds very straightforward. But dear friends, you have to think about the things you are meditating upon. And if they're not good, you need to find a way to get rid of those negatives. Paul said, whatsoever things are of good report. Whatsoever things, notice nextly, are of any virtue. that which causes us to do better. I don't know about you, but I want to surround myself with people that'll help me be better. I don't need help being worse. Believe me, I need help being better. Isn't that what the church is all about? Surrounding ourselves with godly people that help us to be better, that challenge us sometimes, that encourage us to do the right thing. Remember, we're in this world together. We're helping one another go to heaven. Paul was close to this church in Philippi, and one of the things he was encouraging them to do is think right. He said, make sure the things you're thinking about are virtuous. Nextly, he says, if there be any praise. Praise is that which is worth commending to others. One of the greatest things that I enjoy in my life, I love talking about people. You say, whoa, hold on a minute, preacher. Didn't you just condemn gossip? I sure did. I love talking about people's good things. I love it when I see something good happen and I can share that with those I meet. I love it when somebody does something kind for me and I can share that with others. I look for opportunities. I don't do this perfectly. Please, I'm not saying I do this perfectly. But I try to find things that are praiseworthy, things that is worth commending to others. And I'll tell you, I want to share those things. Learn to share things that are praiseworthy. And then I want you to notice carefully in this long list of things, verse 8, Paul says, think on these things. The word think there literally means to meditate upon. It's the same word from which we get our word logic. Paul essentially is saying, deduce from all the evidence of what you're thinking about. Is it true? You need to think about that. Is what I'm thinking about true? Is what I'm thinking about honest? Is it honorable? Is it just? Is it pure? Is it lovely? Is it of good report? Is it a virtuous? Is it praiseworthy? If you can't answer yes to those, then don't think about it. Logically push it out of your thoughts. I'll tell you, Paul understood the importance of thinking right. The Bible helps us to think right. Paul said, learn to pray right. Learn to think right. Now, I want to notice something else here. Paul didn't say, you just need to feel right. Just change your feelings. You see, what did he really focus on? He focused on logic and the mind. Religion is not all about feelings. Christian living is not just about feeling how I feel today. Christian living is about logic, changing the way I think. Christianity and mental soundness go hand in hand. I want you to listen to a quote that a famous American psychiatrist has written. And by the way, this man was a surgeon and he was a doctor. And this is what he wrote regarding this process of thinking. If Christianity were practically applied, he says, to our everyday life, it would so purify and vitalize the race of humanity, that at least one half of our sicknesses and sorrows would disappear. Did you notice that? He said, if we would just apply Christianity, real Christianity, right thinking to our lives, it would get rid of over half of our sicknesses and sorrows. Faith, he continues on, is an actual remedy for those physical ills which result from doubt, depression, and discouragement. I make this statement as a physician, he says, and a surgeon. Fear, he continues, is the cause of worry and nervousness, which are responsible for most of the functional diseases. Can you imagine? He said many of our diseases, our mental ills, are linked to improper thinking. I want you to think for a minute about your life. The anxiety, the stress, the fears, the discouragement, the depression you sometimes face, is it not linked often to what you focus and meditate upon? And I'll tell you, this is easier said than done, but Paul gave us the recipe. Think right. Pray right. Number 3, verse 9, and then we'll conclude our study for today. He said you need to live right. Not only pray right, verses 6 and 7. You need to think right, verse 8, but you need to live right. Right thinking culminates into right living. Notice how he continues the theme. Look at verse 9. Those things which you have both learned and received and heard and seen in me, do, and the God of peace shall be with you. Paul said, you got to put this into action. This has to be part of your daily life. Ralph Waldo Emerson correctly said, a man is what he thinks about all day long. That is so true. A man is what he thinks about all day long. Someone may protest and say, well, you know what? I can't control my thoughts. They just creep up on me. That may be the case. I can relate to that. Why, I've often said I can be sitting, enjoying the most beautiful day, and all of a sudden a negative thought, a bad thought, a sad thought will pop into my head. What do you do about that? What do you do about that, Paul? Well, here's an illustration that may help you. I liken those thoughts to like the birds of the air. Listen, when I go outside today, I can't control which birds fly over my head. But I can control the birds so that they don't build a nest in my head. That's the same way with my thoughts. I may not be able to control the thoughts that come over my head, but dear friends, I don't have to meditate and dwell on those negative thoughts. You see, we all have thoughts sometimes that are not good. So it's not a matter of will I have bad thoughts, but rather will I dwell on those bad thoughts. Right praying, right thinking, right living are the conditions for the secure mind. Paul will pick up in verse 10, and he will talk about, he'll move from God's peace to God's power. I hope you will join us next week. We will probably conclude this book next week, and then we'll delve in to where we're going to head in our studies after the book of Philippians. If you want to read ahead, read verses 10 through the end of the chapter. We'll deal with those next week. I pray that you'll work this week at setting your mind and affections on things above, not on the things of the earth. Colossians 3, 1 through 3. Thank you so much for joining us for our study today. Thank you for being with us and all your encouragement that you give to us. May God bless us as we work at thinking on good things. Thanks again. God bless.